The Cold War between the United States, the Soviet Union, and their allies was a period defined by two world-shaking technologies, high-powered rocketry and nuclear energy. The ultimate marriage of these technologies was the Intercontinental Ballistic Missile, or ICBM, which made near-instant global annihilation a terrifying reality and forever changed the face of warfare and global politics. But nuclear power had other, less violent applications in spaceflight, with both superpowers experimenting with nuclear-powered rockets and actually launching a number of reactor-powered satellites between 1965 and 1988. But what goes up sometimes comes down, and in 1978, a Soviet nuclear-powered satellite tumbled out of the sky and scattered radioactive debris over a vast area of northern Canada, sparking an international incident and one of the largest cleanup operations in history. This is the story of Kosmos 954 and Operation Morning Light. The first country to experiment with using nuclear power in space was the United States, which in the late 1950s launched the Systems for Nuclear Auxiliary Propulsion Project, better known as SNAP. The SNAP program produced two different types of nuclear-powered sources, compact nuclear reactors and radioisotope thermoelectric generators, or RTGs. RTGs consist of a sealed container filled with a radioactive isotope such as plutonium-238. The heat produced by the radioactive decay of the isotope is converted into electricity using thermocouples, the same devices used in digital thermometers. While RTGs produce relatively low amounts of power, on the order of 60 to 80 watts, their longevity, durability, and lack of moving parts make them ideal for spaceflight applications. For a successful space RTG, the 2.5-watt SNAP 3, was launched in 1959 to power the U.S. Navy's Transit 4A and 4B navigation satellites. This was followed by SNAP 9, used on later transit satellites, the SNAP 19, used on the Pioneer 10 and 11 interplanetary probes and the Viking 1 and 2 Mars landers, and SNAP 27, which powered the Apollo Lunar Surface Experiments packages, or ALSEPs, left on the moon by the Apollo 12 through 17 manned missions. Later models included the multi-hundred-watt RTG-powered spacecraft such as the Voyager 1 and 2 interplanetary probes and the Curiosity Mars rover. Versions were also developed for use on Earth, such as to power atomic signal buoys at sea or remote research outposts in the Arctic. While for the most part these devices have proven extraordinarily safe and reliable, mishaps have occurred. For example, on April 21, 1964, the Transit 5BN-3 satellite failed to reach orbit and burned up in the atmosphere, scattering 1 kilogram of plutonium into the upper atmosphere. It was a portent of things to come. The even-numbered SNAP-powered sources, by contrast, were proper nuclear reactors and capable of much higher power outputs. These reactors were fueled by a mixture of enriched uranium and beryllium hydride and cooled using a liquid mixture of sodium and potassium metal. Driven by pumps, the liquid metal coolant carried heat from the reactor core to an array of thermocouples, which, just like in RTGs, converted the thermal energy into electric power. Only one SNAP reactor, SNAP 10A, ever flew into space, launched atop an Atlas Agena D rocket on April 3, 1965. Upon reaching orbit, SNAP 10A successfully powered up and achieved a peak power output of 500 watts. However, after only 43 days, a voltage regulator on the spacecraft failed, causing the reactor to shut down. Though SNAP 10A was a success, the cost and complexity of building space reactors soon led to the project's cancellation, and all subsequent U.S. spacecraft would be powered by solar panels, RTGs, or hydrogen fuel cells. The Soviet Union, meanwhile, developed its own series of compact space reactors, known as the BES-5 and Topaz. These reactors were functionally identical to their American counterparts, being fueled by enriched uranium and cooled with liquid metal. Unlike SNAP, however, the Soviet reactors were used on actual space missions. For example, on December 25, 1971, the Soviets launched Kosmos 469, the first of the USA Radar Ocean Reconnaissance Satellite, or RORSAT, series of unmanned spacecraft. RORSAT was designed to monitor NATO surface vessel and submarine traffic using a powerful side-looking radar system and form part of the Integrated Cosmoplan defense system designed to automatically guide anti-ship missiles against enemy naval forces. As the resolution of the radar dropped off significantly with altitude, the RORSATs had to be placed in as low of Earth orbit as possible. Had the spacecraft been solar-powered, however, the large solar arrays would have generated excessive drag as they skimmed the upper atmosphere, causing the spacecraft's orbit to quickly decay. Thus, Rorsats were instead powered by the more compact BES-5 and later Topaz reactors, designed to generate up to 3 to 5 kilowatts of electrical power over 3 to 5 years. To prevent radioactive material from re-entering the atmosphere and contaminating the Earth, the satellites were equipped with a mechanism to eject their reactor core into a safe disposable orbit at the end of their missions. Between 1971 and 1988, 27 nuclear power Rorsat satellites were successfully launched into orbit, while plagued by major reliability issues, with the longest-lived satellite operating for only 134 days, the system nonetheless allowed the Soviets to continuously monitor nearly every square kilometer of the Earth's oceans in real time, a capability achieved by no other satellite system before or since. So powerful was the system that during the 1982 Falklands War between the United Kingdom and Argentina, the Soviet Navy was able to obtain a real-time play-by-play of the British landings. But attaining this capability came with significant risks, as the nation of Canada was to learn in January of 1978. Kosmos 954, the 11th of the Rorsat satellites, was launched from the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan on September the 18th, 1977. While at first the satellite appeared to function normally, by December it had become clear that something was very, very wrong. Satellite trackers around the world, including NORAD and the UK-based Kettering Group, discovered that Kosmos 954 was behaving erratically, abruptly changing its orbital altitude by up to 80 kilometers. Before long, the US contacted the Soviets, who on January the 14th sheepishly confirmed their worst fears. Kosmos 954 was out of control and would re-enter the atmosphere over Canada later that month. Worse still, the mechanism designed to safely eject the satellite's reactor core had failed, meaning the resulting debris would be heavily contaminated with uranium-235. And so it was that the world collectively held its breath as the satellite's orbit dropped lower and lower, bracing for what could very well turn out to be the largest nuclear disaster in history. The end finally came on January the 24th, 1978, as Kosmos 954, on its 2,060th orbit, plunged into the atmosphere and broke up over the Queen Charlotte Islands on Canada's west coast. To everyone's relief, the satellite did not land near a major population center, instead scattering radioactive debris over a 600-kilometer path stretching from Great Slave Lake to Baker Lake, an area encompassing parts of modern-day provinces and territories of Saskatchewan, Alberta, Nunavut, and the Northwest Territories. Nevertheless, this entire area would have to be thoroughly decontaminated. Thankfully, even before the Kosmos 954 had fallen to Earth, the U.S. National Security Council's Ad Hoc Committee on Space Debris had organized a massive joint U.S.-Canadian cleanup mission, dubbed Operation Morning Light. The task facing the men of Operation Morning Light, which at its peak numbered some 220 Canadians and American military and civilian personnel, was a daunting one. The vast search area encompassed some of the world's most rugged and remote terrain, a wilderness of tundra, boreal forests, lakes, and rivers with few human settlements and almost no roads. Worse still, Kosmos 954 had come down in the darkest depths of the Arctic winter when temperatures regularly plunged below negative 40 degrees Celsius. This harsh environment proved challenging not only to the searchers, but to their equipment as well. Originally, the personnel tasked with overflying the search area and locating the highest concentrations of radioactive debris came from the American Atomic Energy Commission's Nuclear Emergency Search Team, or NEST, based out of Las Vegas, Nevada. NEST's regular duties involved flying over the Nevada test site following underground nuclear weapons tests in order to detect any radiation leakage to the surface. Shortly after the Kosmos 954 re-entered the atmosphere, NEST arrived at the Operation Morning Light staging area in Nomeo, Alberta, in 5 Lockheed C-141 Starlifter heavy lift transport aircraft. The transports carried not only the 120 members of the team, but also 2 helicopters equipped with gamma-ray spectrograph radiation detectors and a complete mobile communications center, including 2 mobile data processing vehicles jokingly nicknamed bread vans. However, this equipment designed for use in the hot, dry desert of Nevada proved no match for the Canadian Arctic and quickly began to break down. The scintillation crystals used in the aircraft-mounted radiation detectors proved especially sensitive to humidity and low temperatures and were soon rendered all but useless. Thankfully, a solution was quickly found. In 1966, the Commercial Products Division of Atomic Energy of Canada Limited, or AECL, had begun developing a device called the Airborne Gamma Ray Spectrometer, or AGRS. Mounted on a helicopter or other aircraft, AGRS was designed to detect low levels of radiation emanating from minerals in the ground, allowing for the efficient location of deposits of uranium, thorium, and other resources. Specifically developed for use in northern Canada, AGR units proved far better suited to Arctic conditions than the American equipment and were successfully used throughout the recovery effort. And so it was that from January to late May 1978, spectrometer-equipped aircraft crisscrossed the recovery area in search of large concentrations of debris, while personnel on foot swept the ground with handheld radiation detectors. Locals were also instructed to report, but not touch, any fallen strange objects they stumbled upon. At first, the search teams failed to find any debris in the predicted areas. However, the U.S. Army's meteorological section soon discovered that unusual heating in the stratosphere had altered the satellite's reentry path, allowing the search area to be recalculated. The first confirmed piece of debris was discovered on January the 26th near the mouth of the Hoarfrost River, while on February the 23rd, the most intensely radioactive piece was recovered on the frozen surface of the Great Slave Lake. A metal flake the size of a nickel, the piece registered a radiation level of 1.1 sieverts per hour, enough to kill a grown human after only a few hours of exposure. In total, some 4,000 fragments of Kosmos 954 were recovered, the debris being sent first to Edmonton, Alberta, and then to Whitechapel Nuclear Research Establishment in Pinawa, Manitoba for analysis and disposal. With the spring breakup of the lake and river ice imminent, the first phase of Operation Morning Light came to an end on April the 20th, 1978. In total, the searchers had logged over 4,500 hours of flying time and covered an area of 124,000 square kilometers. A second search phase was carried out from July to October 1978 and succeeded in clearing all remaining inhabited areas and nature preserves of all radioactive material. Analysis of the recovered debris confirmed that the satellite's reactor had almost completely vaporized as it re-entered the atmosphere, eliminating the possibility that a large, highly dangerous section of the core had made it to the ground. Furthermore, most of the debris had fallen into areas of abundant lakes and rivers, which safely encased and prevented it from being released into the environment. Overall, the impact of the Kosmos 954 crash was far less severe than many had feared. Though it could have been far, far worse. Had re-entry occurred only 3 orbits earlier, the satellite would have strewn debris over an area stretching from the Hudson Bay to the Gulf of Mexico, placing major population centers such as Toronto and Detroit at risk. As you might expect, the Kosmos 954 incident caused something of a diplomatic row between Canada and the Soviet Union. You see, under the terms of the 1972 Convention on International Liability for Damages Caused by Space Objects, the state which launches an object into space is liable for any damages incurred by that object. In total, both phases of Operation Morning Light cost the Canadian government more than $14 million, of which $6 million was billed to the Soviet government. However, the Soviets only eventually agreed to pay $3 million. In the end, while the crash of the Kosmos 954 caused worldwide panic and should have served as a warning, sadly it was neither the first nor the last RORSAT to fall to Earth. Both the second unnamed RORSAT on April the 25th, 1973, and Kosmos 1402 on February the 7th, 1983, failed in a similar manner, though thankfully these spacecraft and the reactors landed safely in the ocean. Later RORSATs were equipped with backup systems to ensure that their reactor cores were safely ejected into disposal orbits. However, these nonetheless caused problems even when they worked as designed. You see, thanks to 16 RORSAT core ejections, approximately 128 kilograms of liquid sodium potassium coolant has been released into orbit, creating a highly radioactive cloud of debris that poses a significant threat to other spacecraft and astronauts. And so, just like the renewed threat of nuclear Armageddon currently hanging over our heads, the legacy of the Cold War military brinksmanship continues to cast a long shadow over our present-day world.